Hey everyone, I'm back with another editing video for you guys. Today I wanted to talk about manuscript editing and everything that that entails. I get a lot of emails from aspiring editors, and actually I get a lot of emails from professional editors who maybe work in a different field or a different kind of editing who are looking to switch gears and start manuscript editing. It's quite a different process entirely, and while I can't get into every aspect of manuscript editing in this video, I'm hoping to touch on the most important things. So today we're gonna talk about resources, style sheets, and electronic editing, or more specifically, Word's track changes feature. So I'll try and leave timestamps down below if you want to go ahead and skip to the part that you want to watch. So first, I want to touch on resources, and I could actually make a whole separate video on this. I'm sure I will at some point this month, and I'm sure I have in previous videos, but we're going to take it a little bit deeper. Some of you guys have heard me talk about the Chicago Manual of Style. I talk about it all day long. I refer to it all day long in my editing career. But we haven't really talked about what that looks like on a day-to-day basis. I have two ways of consulting the Chicago Manual of Style. One is my physical copy, which you guys have seen. It's covered in annotations and tabs so that I can find what I need to find easily. I also have an online subscription, and I highly, highly recommend this to anyone who wants to look into manuscript editing as a viable career. An online subscription is amazing because there's so many forums that you can look up. You can ask any question at all in the search bar. And usually you'll find what you're looking for if you dig hard enough. It's a little bit faster sometimes than consulting the physical copy, although I still have places in my physical copy that are just easier for me to flip through. If the price of the online subscription is something that concerns you, consider going in with a group for like a group rate. I know that some of the associations that I'm a part of offer discounts for people in that association. So definitely look into that. Otherwise, I would say it's so worth it. I also have my Merriam-Webster's Collegiate Dictionary, and most publishers and editorial agencies do require that editors and authors use this dictionary. It's one of the more popular ones. I have an online subscription for this dictionary as well, and I will say that I probably use my online subscription way more than I reach for my physical copy. But occasionally I do reach for the physical copy. I also occasionally edit Christian manuscripts, so I have a whole separate style guide that I use really as a supplement for the Chicago Manual, and it's called the Christian Writer's Manual of Style. Again, I use it with the Chicago Manual of Style, but it is a resource that I use often. I also have a binder full of storytelling technique flyers that I've compiled over the years. They're basically chock full of examples and definitions and helpful things that authors, a lot of first-time authors or authors looking to grow their craft, are interested in. A lot of my flyers come from editing courses that I've taken, just notes that I've compiled, personal experiences. These are really, really helpful to have at my desk that I can reference to maybe with heavier copy edits so that I can just quickly jot a note to an author if there's something that's particularly relevant. I also have a file on my computer for resources full of documents from classes and the storytelling technique flyers that I have. So basically I have a digital version and a physical copy for most of my resources, and I found that it's just so helpful to do it that way. I would honestly be lost without those resources for my classes, and I actually talked about this in my How to Become an Editor video, I think, which I'll link down below. But I will, if you go and watch that video, you'll know all the classes that I initially took to get started as an editor. Side note, I'm pursuing my editing certificate through the University of Chicago Graham School currently, and I'm 3 classes down, 2 more to go, and I'm so excited about that. All that to say, the list is growing. It's important to constantly stay learning and sharpening your skills and expanding your skills. So the second thing I want to talk about is style sheets. And style sheets can be a bit of a foreign concept for a lot of new editors, but it is so important to note specific details as you edit or proofread along the way. Mostly this has to do with keeping language consistent and abiding by specific stylistic rules. A few specifics to note could be text, font and size, titles, headings, subheadings, numbers, capitalization, punctuation. Usually I keep a word list to kind of keep track of how the author is treating certain words with variant spellings to make sure it's all consistent across the board. For instance, if an author spells the word okay, okay, instead of okay, that's the kind of small detail that I would want to note in a style chain, in a style guide. Sometimes it's also helpful for fiction editors to keep a character list, so that you're making sure that characters' names are spelled correctly throughout. For content editing or continuity editing, you may want to have a list of the characters defining features like their eye color, their hair color, and things like that to make sure it's consistent, and to make sure that one character's hair color doesn't change from chapter 1 to chapter 5. Timelines can also be helpful with style sheets to just kind of make sure that there's a proper time lapse between events. I actually think these are really helpful steps for authors to take before they pass along their manuscripts to publishers or literary agents or editors, mainly because it helps the author understand what his or her preferences are. If there's a certain convention that he or she uses, it's helpful to just know what you like and what you don't like, and to just make it as consistent and polished as possible before you pass it on to that next step. If you're new to manuscript editing, I would recommend checking out some templates, some style sheet templates online. I'm sure a quick Google search can help you with that, or check out the copy editor's handbook. I've mentioned that in previous videos, I'm sure, but I think that there might be a whole chapter devoted to style sheets, or at least a couple of pages, just for reference. It's really helpful to see examples of style sheets. The third thing I want to talk about is electronic editing, and specifically Microsoft Word's track changes feature. This is something that, as a book editor, honestly, as an editor for other kinds of businesses far from the publishing industry, learning how to use track changes has been so key in my business. I would say learning how to navigate track changes is just as important for authors, if not more so, than editors, because authors have to know how to accept or reject changes. They have to know how to read certain comment bubbles and things like that to get the valuable feedback that they need to make their manuscript the best it can be. And I actually recently created a document that's basically just how to use track changes to equip authors, because there have been times where I've had to get on the phone and explain with an author how to use track changes, or, you know, back and forth email exchange, and that just takes a lot of time. So if you're trying to grow your editing business, those are the kind of things you want to kind of figure out how to push aside. I've spent so much time and energy trying to explain track changes to authors before, but I would say the majority of people know how to use track changes, or they're familiar with it at least somewhat. So yes, if you're not familiar with it, I highly, highly recommend spending a few hours or minutes even figuring it out. If you're not familiar with track changes, basically it's a feature that allows every change that you make to be redlined in the document, so the client can see your suggested deletions and additions. When the client opens the files that you've edited with this feature, he or she can kind of put the cursor over the text and right click, and there will be this little box that pops up. This allows the client to either accept or reject the change that you've made. You can also add comments to your suggestions or edits by going to the comment bubble feature, although you do need to make sure that the author is familiar with track changes, because sometimes it can show, it can be invisible on their end. They may have to go in on their end and turn on the show comments option. Comments can be shown either in the balloons in the right margin, as I mentioned, or at the very bottom of the manuscript in a little box. If you're an editor working with somebody who isn't as familiar with track changes, I highly recommend making your comments after the change in the text with brackets, maybe like a Q, colon, to ask a question if you need to query the author, But that way, the author will not miss what you're wanting him or her to know. If you're looking for more helpful information on track changes, check out Hillary Powers' Making Word Work for You. There's a lot of helpful information in there specifically about track changes. I'll include a few links in the description box down below that are basically just short guides for authors and editors learning how to use track changes. As an editor working with track changes, it's really important not to overwhelm the author with all of the redline edits. Sometimes it can feel really overwhelming at first. And this is something that's not always easy to avoid, but basically one way you can make sure that it's not too overwhelming is to make one comment as it pertains to that rule or issue, and if it's a global issue, just kind of make that comment, and then every time it comes up after that, you can just make the change in the text. For example, if an author hasn't been using the Oxford comma, which is something that the Chicago Manual of Style strongly recommends, then you might make a little comment bubble, make the change in the text, add the Oxford comma, and then make a comment bubble and say, is this okay? This is the rule for Chicago. You know, provide the information for why you're making the change. And then every time you need an Oxford comma after that, you can just insert it in the text. Also, don't feel like you have to keep track changes on for really minor things like double spaces. If there's double spaces all over the text, turn track changes off and then do the find, replace all double spaces to one space so that you're fixing it all in one go, and then turn track changes back on, because some of those kinds of changes the author doesn't need to see. It's not something the author is going to disagree with or have questions about, so a lot of formatting kind of changes like that, like indentation changes, you don't need to have track changes on to fix those issues. Another tip I have for editors using track changes is to uncheck the insertions and deletions box in the show markup category in track changes. Basically, it just kind of clears it up for you. It's not as cluttered with all of the redline edits that you have. Sometimes it's really easy to introduce errors if you're viewing all of the insertions and deletions, just because you can't really see the clean copy. Also, if you feel like a comment that you're making is paragraphs and paragraphs long and it's just too much to have in the text, you can always include those kinds of comments in an editorial letter or in the email if it's something that's a major issue that you want the author to know about. Feel free to make the change in the text and then include something in an email or an editorial letter about that change. I could go on and on about editing tips, specifically electronic editing tips, but I feel like this could be a really long video, so I'm going to leave you with that. I'm sure I'll touch on this topic again at some point this month, which is really kind of fun because I feel like I have so much room to share all the things that I'm learning with you guys. And there's no rush to fit it all into one video. So if you've been watching my NaNoWriMo series, thank you. I hope that you'll consider subscribing and commenting and liking this video. And I will see you tomorrow. Bye.